Gopijana Balabha Giribhara Dhani
Gopijana Balabha Giribhara Dhani
Jasara Nandana Vraja Janaranjana
Yashoda Nandana Vraja
Jasara Nandana Vraja Janaranjana Namastasmai Bhagavate
Namastasmai Bhagavate
Vasudevaya Vedase
Vasudevaya Vedase
Bhagurgyanam Ayam Saumya
Bhagurgyanam Ayam Saumya
Yanmukham Guru Hasavam
Yanmukham Guru Hasavam
Namastasmai Bhagavate
Namastasmai Bhagavate
एतसे
वासुदेवाय एतसे
वपुर्ज्ञानम् अयम् सौम्या
वपुर्ज्ञानमयम् सौम्या
यन्मुखाम् गुरु हासवम्
यन्मुखाम् गुरु हासवम् नमस्तस्मै भगवते
नमस्तस्मै भगवते
वासुदेवाय वेदसे
वासुदेवाय वेदसे
वपुर्ज्ञानमयम् सौम्या
वपुर्ज्ञानमयम् सौम्या
यन्मुखाम्बुरहावसम्
यन्मुखाम्बुरहासवम्
नमस्तस्मै भगवते
वासुदेवाय
वेदसे
प्रभुर्ज्ञानमयं
सौम्या यन्मुखां गुरुहासवम्
system of transcendental knowledge, Srila Shuddhar Swami has commented that the respectful obeisances are offered to Srila Vyasadeva, who is the incarnation of Vasudeva. Srila Jiva Goswami has agreed with this, but Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur has made a further advance, namely that the nectar from the mouth of Lord Krishna is transferred to his different consorts and thus they learn the finer arts of music, dance, dressing, decorations, and all such things which are relished by the Lord. Such music, dance, and decorations enjoyed by the Lord are certainly not anything mundane, because the Lord is addressed in the very beginning as para, or transcendental. This transcendental knowledge is unknown to the forgotten conditioned souls. Srila Vyasadeva, who is the incarnation of the Lord, thus compiled the Vedic literatures to revive the lost memory of the conditioned souls about their eternal relation with the Lord. One should, therefore, try to understand the Vedic scriptures or the nectar transferred by the Lord to his consorts in the conjugal humor from the lotus-like mouth of Vyasadeva or Shukadeva Goswami, or Shukadeva. By gradual development of transcendental knowledge, one can rise to the stage of the transcendental art of music and dance displayed by the Lord in his Rasa-lila. But without having the Vedic knowledge, one can hardly understand the transcendental nature of the Lord's rasa dance and music. The pure devotees of the Lord, however, can equally relish the nectar in the form of the profound philosophical discourses and in the form of kissing by the Lord in the rasa dance, as there is no mundane distinction between the two. Well, process of creation indeed. Namastasmai Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Veda say, Papur Jnanam Ayam Saumya Janmukham Guru Hasavam. I offer my respectful obeisances unto Srila Vyasadeva. The incarnation of Vasudeva, who compiled the Vedic scriptures. The pure devotees drink up the nectarian transcendental knowledge dropping from the lotus-like mouth of the Lord. Reference here is to para. Seems to be in the purport, text 24. This transcendental knowledge. Okay, here we go. Such music, dance, and decorations enjoyed by the Lord are certainly not anything mundane, because the Lord is addressed in the very beginning as para, or transcendental. Well, it's not, the word para is not here in this verse. So maybe earlier in the summary that Shukadeva Goswami is giving, the word para is there, but certainly the word para is there in the very introductory verses of the entire Bhagavatam. Paradharma. The message of Srimad Bhagavatam is Paradharma. The message of Bhagavad Gita is also Paradharma. At least the concluding teaching of Bhagavad Gita is Paradharma. That Paradharma is exclusive devotion to the Personality of Godhead, and all other dharmas are subordinate and subsidiary, secondary to the Paradharma. That's transcendental knowledge. that the beginning of transcendental knowledge is making a distinction between matter and spirit. Sankhya philosophy, chapter 2, Bhagavad Gita. Transcendental knowledge, the distinction between that which is eternal and that which is temporary. And material conception doesn't permit that. Or doesn't explore even the possibility of it. Rather, the attempt is just to understand things within the sphere of matter. Little anecdotal story. Keep it short. When I was in high school, at the high school that I went to, there was a program, the American Field Service, AFS. And the program was somebody from our school went to attend their senior year in the school somewhere out of this country, and someone from another country came to our school to attend their senior year in high school. And it was going on all over the country. Person from overseas and someone going overseas and doing their final year of study. So when I was a senior in high school, my parents took part in that, and someone came to our home. And the person that came to our home was from Tokyo. His name was Ken Ijiri. And he was brilliant. He was kind of bored with, you know, the inferior quality of education in America. And after he graduated, we maintained contact a little bit. But the next time I was in touch with him was after he had just completed his third PhD. His first PhD in the University of Tokyo, which is like, you know, an Ivy League school in Tokyo, was in mathematics. And then the next one was in physics. And the third one, which he was completing at the University of Michigan, was in biochemistry, his third PhD. And his project, so he contacted me after he finished his third PhD, said, I'd like to visit you in New York. I haven't seen the Statue of Liberty. I'd like to see the Statue of Liberty. I didn't say I haven't seen it either, but, you know, sure, come on over and we'll go see the Statue of Liberty together. So, riding in the subway from Midtown Manhattan, going to, because the Statue of Liberty is always the bottom of Manhattan. I asked him, what you do your PhD in? This third one. He said the division from one cell into two cell of frogs, that was his PhD, using math, physics, and biochemistry. What causes the cell of a frog to go from one to two? And just out of curiosity, I said, what if it required the presence of a soul in order for that to happen? What if? And his answer was, well, as a scientist, we can't even discuss that possibility. And I thought that was a very honest answer, because the purview of science goes only as far as those things that you can measure with, you know, the senses or extended facility of the senses, like a microscope or some other kind of mechanism, some other kind of machine. Science can talk about empiric, but not spiritual knowledge. So rather than saying, oh, that's not possible, or the soul doesn't exist, or some other kind of thing like that. He said, it's not within the purview of science to even entertain that possibility. If it's so, we would never know, because science doesn't reach into that arena. We can only speak about that which we can measure. And I was thinking, I wish other scientists were equally honest as him. So rather than saying, there's no such thing, he says, we'll never know. And transcendental knowledge is specifically hearing about that which lies beyond the senses, and for that matter, it lies beyond the mind. Because the mind can only go so far, and the realm of spirit is beyond that. So no matter how powerful one is as a muni or a speculator, you'll never know. Because it's beyond the capacity of the senses and the mind to know. You can speculate and say, perhaps, maybe. Or you can speculate and say, what existed before what we can measure might have been, in my opinion, it seems to me that, and then you know. So the combination of senses and mind can come up with a theory. But you'll never know. The Bhagavatam is teaching us, and Bhagavad Gita is teaching us about things that you can't know by those methods, but you can know by disclosure. I'm going to speak about this in midday a little bit. Chapter 10. Bhagavad Gita. The Vedas are coming from that realm. The Sanskrit term is apurusheya shabda, which means beyond the fallibility of human beings, from a source that's not a man, but apurusheya, a transcendental sound vibration, and then that can disclose transcendence, what lies beyond matter. And the laws governing matter. Otherwise we won't know. So the compiler the source of that knowledge is Narayana, who lies in that transcendental realm. And then that sound, according to the Vedic wisdom, it exists before the periodic creation, maintenance, and destruction of the universe. The prakat, manifest, and then maintenance, and then withdrawal, and then unmanifest, and then again, manifest, maintenance, withdrawal. So it's existing, it's primordial sound. That which you can't measure by instruments that require the sense perception to read them, or the mind to interpret what that information might imply. It's pre-existing beyond this realm. That's what the word transcendental means. And Bhagavatam is revealing transcendence. So that knowledge was manifest in a written form, keeping it really simple, by Vyas. And Vyas taught it to Shukadeva. So, rightly so, Shukadeva is honoring Vyas. Because that's what a student does. They honor the teacher that gives them knowledge. Otherwise, they won't be able to receive the knowledge. They'll receive something, but it won't be the knowledge that's given to them. They'll receive something that's their mind, that says, yeah, that's right, and it may not even be what was given. It's just the conception that one is holding in one's mind, but that's all that goes in, is the mind that's cluttered with material conceptions. And that's all you can hear. So for, even for mundane knowledge, but particularly for transcendental knowledge, there must be this relationship of honoring the source of transcendental knowledge. In the case of Shukadeva Goswami, he's the perfect speaker of Srimad Bhagavatam, the perfect recipient of his transcendental knowledge from Vyas, and he understands who Vyasa is. There's a very interesting section in Vishnu Purana, one of the Sattvic Puranas, that's spoken by Parashur Muni. Parashur Muni was the father of Vyasadeva. And there's an interesting story of how he became the father of Vyasadeva, but Parashur Muni understood that his son, well, it's in the pastime. In the pastime, Parashur Muni was crossing a river, and he was doing some calculations, astrological calculations, and it came to his attention that at this particular auspicious period of time, some muhurta period of time, an incarnation of the Supreme Lord is to appear.